as a kid straight out of college, I was making kind of low six figures, which was amazing, more than my dad ever made his whole life. And so for me, the pursuit of success with a financial goal wasn't my end game. And I found very quickly that when you have more money than you need, you don't necessarily feel very fulfilled. Money was never a motivator for me. It was just an effect from the, you know, whatever the cause was. Our employees and their kids started being pen pals with the kids we're sponsoring, and all our kids we sponsor in Senegal is in Senegal. So we started building community with them.
I just got goosebumps. I got goosebumps over my whole body hearing that.
Welcome, high-performing entrepreneurs and business owners. Do you suffer from shiny object syndrome? Do you often feel scattered and distracted, making it hard to implement your plan with all the ideas and strategies coming at you? Do you often wonder if you have the right goals and plan? Welcome to Extraordinary Focus with David Wood, where we help you achieve way more in less time. Get the laser focus you need so you can double your business, double your impact in the world, and be an even more extraordinary entrepreneur and human. Let's dive in and stay tuned at the end for your gift.
Welcome everybody to another episode of Extraordinary Focus with David Wood. I'm joined today by Brian Roland. And Brian, before I read out your bio, welcome to the show.
Thanks so much. I love your wings.
Thanks, man. All right. Yeah. If you can't see the video, guys, I got wings right now, which represent freedom. I'm excited to talk to Brian because Brian is a social entrepreneur. And we're going to talk about how you can give through your business and maybe even make more money through your giving. So he's a social entrepreneur and founder of Abenity, which powers corporate perks for top brands, including US Bank and Mastercard. That impressed me. While Abenity provides millions of subscribers with private discounts, the company's social mission is fighting extreme poverty with every program they deliver, recently exceeding $1 million of total giving, and hired a CEO to accelerate growth. Brian helps like-minded entrepreneurs establish a social mission of their own, and that's what excited me. So, Brian, anything else that people should know about you before we dive into how you became a Fortune or an Inc. 5000 company?
Yeah, I think that's a great start. We've been on a mission for a long time to help employees of companies stretch their hard-earned money further by offering these corporate perks and discounts. And we've recently opened that up to the small business vertical with employees of less than 150 employees. Most of the companies we serve are around 5,000 plus.
All right. So let's suppose I've got a company with 5,000 plus employees. Yep. I'm trying to understand this corporate perks thing. What is it that you do for my company?
Yeah. So Abenity offers private discounts and corporate rates on everything from pizza in the zoo to movie tickets, oil changes, car rentals, hotels. So we've pre-negotiated these private offers.
So you'll give my employees access to a whole bunch of discounts and perks.
Yep. So large companies usually have 20 to 50 of their own discounts that they're having trouble managing. So our platform manages those existing relationships and then aggregates our private relationships that we've negotiated on top of it.
Oh, okay.
And we brand the whole thing from the front end to the back end for the employer. So when you buy your Disneyland ticket with us, your company's logo goes all the way to the box office with the employee, and the employee saves, you know, a couple hundred dollars off their tickets.
So, wow. So my Disney ticket will actually have the corporate logo on there. Wow. Yep. That's really cool. And then how do you make your money? Is it the company pays or the people providing all the perks pay or both?
Yeah, great question. So in the corporate benefits space, funding is usually made through insurance commissions on the back end is a popular way for vendors to make money. Or it's made in the markup of the tickets and the inventory. We've flipped really the industry upside down by saying, hey, companies, you'll pay a flat monthly fee, $150 a month for small businesses, up to $2,500 a month, but it's a flat monthly fee based on the services we're managing, not the number of people that are subscribing.
Right.
It's a very affordable rate. And then we give the wholesale rates, the deepest discounts possible, to the employees. So they're saving more through us than they would as a AAA member or through AARP or something like that, because we're not marking it up on the back end.
Oh, so you don't actually take a cut from the companies that are providing the perks. You just upfront fee, and then they get the best deal possible.
We always give the best deal possible. In some cases, there's some advertising dollars in it for us, but not at the expense of the members' discounts, for sure.
Right. Say more about the advertising dollars, because I want to understand this model. Where do these advertising dollars come in?
Well, yeah. So our goal is to negotiate the best discounts possible we can for our members. We have about 3 million registered members today. We add about 1,500 new people every day from our client network. And so on the advertising side, we don't want, unless it's a restaurant or an activities category, the more of those, the merrier. But we don't want five or more vendors all in the same category. So it becomes a way for us to build quality. So we say, make us the best discount offer and tell us what kind of advertising package you'd want to help us engage the members with your best offer. And so we look at it that way.
Oh, so you provide ads to the members, and when they log into the portal and they're getting all the discounts, you provide advertising of other people's products to that base.
We're essentially featuring products that are paid placement in a lot of cases to further engagement. But to get in the door of our program, you have to offer a discount. So we're adding featured positioning and stuff like that.
Right. Okay. I like it. Yeah. And how does one become an Inc. 5,000 company? I know you've been six times an Inc. 5,000 company. What do you got to do to qualify for that?
Yeah, it's all math, really. So you have to have a minimum of $2 million in annual revenue. And then it takes a 3-year average of your growth. And so the 5,000 companies with the highest growth percentage over that 3-year average make the list. So
all right.
It's pretty data driven. It's not one of those certificates where you show up to a luncheon and get sold something. It's a nice honor.
I'm just Googling right now, and maybe the answer to this. How many companies are in the US?
Oh gosh, I don't know. But I know to make it on Inc. 5,000 three times, you're in like single digit percents of companies that can do that. So to make it six times is extremely rare.
Well, even making it once, it looks like there are 10.75 million companies in the US. So to make it to the top 5,000 is pretty amazing. And to be there six times sounds like you're here to stay. So congratulations on that. Let's talk about social entrepreneurship. Yep. It looks like you recently exceeded giving $1 million. So why let me see what order I want to ask these questions in. What is social entrepreneurship? So yep. At least have a common ground for that.
Great, great question. So you've got, you essentially have nonprofits who invest their work into a cause. And then you have for-profits who traditionally are using their success and have an arm of corporate social responsibility, which is this CSR is a big part of their annual reports and all this. And that's CSR is kind of a reactive something that they do in the community. Nonprofits are very proactive, but they're fully donor funded. So they only make money from donations.
Yep.
Social entrepreneurship fits in the middle, which says we're going to build a sustainable model that has that for every input into the business, for all the revenue that comes in from our sales or from our customer support, output to a cause. And so it's not a reactive thing on the back end, like corporate social responsibility, where the board of directors is saying, what do we want to do to raise our CSR flag and show everybody we're a good company? And it's not a donor funded initiative that requires donor funding to keep going. It's a sustainable cause. And Tom Shoes is maybe the most famous. There's others that are that fit in the mix too.
Okay. I missed what CSR stands for. What is it?
Sorry, corporate social responsibility.
Corporate social responsibility. Okay. So, so at one end, you've got people just full on charity driven, funder driven, doing good stuff for the world, not making a profit. Then you've got corporations making a profit, and they might decide, hey, what are we going to do to raise our profile or to be socially responsible or to look good? We're going to donate money this way. But then you've got in the middle, we are a for-profit company with a built-in component for every dollar of revenue or profit. We're going to do this like Tom's shoes. We get, you know, you buy a pair of shoes, we give a pair of shoes. Okay. Why did you get, and how did you get interested in
that? Yeah, it's a great, great question. So straight out of school, I took a job in sales, selling phones. And, you know, my dad is an architect and he worked for the government and for hospitals growing up. We're middle-class family. I wasn't used to making or being around a lot of money, but I did well in sales. And pretty quickly as a kid straight out of college, I was making kind of low six figures, which was amazing. More than my dad ever made his whole life. And so for me, the pursuit of success with a financial goal wasn't my end game. And I found very quickly that when you have more money than you need, you don't necessarily feel very fulfilled. You're not finding purpose in that. And so it was starting our company with a cause was really for me to find meaning in work. And ultimately my calculus that based the decision on was like, look, work's going to be hard. There's always going to be a fire to put out. Something's always going to go wrong. And I need to have something that I'm working toward and working for that's outside of my product, outside of my services, outside of my industry. Because all three of those are going to let me down at some point. And it's really easy to throw in the towel when that happens. And when you're working for a cause, especially with what happened last year, you have something to fight for that's bigger than yourselves. And it really gets you going long term. Now, what I didn't expect was all the unexpected perks that come out of running a social business as you're building as a team, as you're building a profile in the marketplace. And so I've identified six kind of unexpected perks that came from starting a social business that I've written a little bit about and enjoy talking about.
Wow, I want to hear about those perks. And this is kind of blowing my mind a little bit, or at least stopping my mind. The interview I did yesterday was about motivation and motivation as a currency that we need to nurture and protect. Because if you don't have a lot of motivation, it's hard to make a lot of money and a lot of impact. But what you're saying is, if I have a cause that's part of the business and it's not just for me, but this is actually helping people I care about, then that's a motivator that's going to get me through the hard times.
That's a great way to say it.
I had not thought about that as using cause marketing to get myself out of bed. And I really, really like that. So what are the six?
Yep.
And by the way, I am struck by the fact that you are making more than your dad straight out of college. Which is the way it should be. We should all learn from our parents and all do better than our parents. So I'm pretty impressed by that, low six figures. And it sounds like you also discovered, okay, I'm making money, but it doesn't necessarily give me meaning. You know, maybe if you're Trump, money is the way to keep score, but it sounds like you've found another way to keep score, which is the number of people impacted.
That's right. Money was never a motivator for me. It was just it was an effect from the, you know, whatever the cause was I was running after. It was, it's what came from where I put my passion. And I think that's really, I've heard a lot of people say that is when you pursue your passion, when you take care of other people first, like the money kind of follows the impact that you're making.
So would you blame the fact that you're earning over $2 million in revenue, you would blame that on the fact that you have a solid cause that you care about.
Absolutely. In fact, the first unexpected perk of running a social business is a competitive advantage. And I never expected it. And really the first, let's see, probably 6 years of our business from when we established a formula, an output to our cause for every input into the business. And everybody has to pick their cause. What are they going to fight for? What do they care about? For us, we picked the biggest problem we could think of, which was extreme poverty. It's also the United Nations number one sustainability goal is to eradicate extreme poverty by 2030. So we're like, look, that's 20 years away. Let's jump on that. Let's jump on that and push towards that. What we didn't expect, but we kept it private. I mean, we came from, you know, I really think the way you personally give is a private matter. It's not something you really need to talk about with openly because it can be seen the wrong way. It can be seen as bragging or, but when it comes to a business, so we treated our business that way to begin with. Like we don't need to tell people what we're doing, what we're supporting with our business. But we had a turning point where we're like, I think we could include more people in our cause and we could do more for our cause by being more transparent with what we're doing. And right. So we kind of came out with our social mission and published it everywhere. And it's a common sales thing to say, hey, people like to do business with people they like. And that's true. And good salespeople that are likable benefit from that. But I think it's time that we add and companies they trust. And yeah. when you build an impact brand, you are building instant credibility and trust for your brand because of the way that you're publicly supporting another well-known but completely separate cause. And so
that sounds really clear. So you've got a competitive advantage because you're being transparent with what you're doing. People trust you more. They're more likely to buy from you than the dude who isn't giving money. That makes sense. What's the second perk?
Yep, absolutely. So for me, I was interested in meaningful work for myself. That was my motivator. The second one is meaningful teamwork. As we started to build a team, we started telling them about our cause, about our social mission, about what we were doing. And we were attractive to people that were attracted to working for the same kind of cause. And that gave personal meaning to each member's work of our team. And so each of our team members came on and they also had meaning at work that was outside of the product, the service, the industry. And that became very valuable.
All right. So it becomes part of the culture.
It became part of the culture. And that's number three is cultural alignment formed around meaningful work as a team. And by aligning ourselves around a common cause, that created a shared purpose, which is number four. Within the company. And I wrote an article breaking all these out called The Unexpected Perks of a Social Mission. But shared purpose became something that we really were able to rally around. Number five, we took shared purpose and we created purpose-driven KPIs, purpose-driven metrics. So instead of we specifically sponsor a child in extreme poverty with every customer that comes on and subscribes to us. So instead of counting new customers and new clients, instead of setting sales goals based on clients, we set sponsorship goals. We want to sponsor this many kids. We count kids we sponsor instead of customers we onboard. And when we lose customers, which inevitably happens, well, we're thinking about the kids and essentially getting the kids adopted by the next customer. We hold them in between, but the next customer that comes on picks up a kid that was no longer being sponsored from a client that moved on for some reason.
Wow. I love that. I want to check your website quickly. And I'm assuming if I go to, what's the website for
Brian Roland? For Abenity?
Yeah.
Abenity.com, Abenity.com.
Right. I'm assuming if I go to the website right now, I'll see an example of the impact that you're having. Would that be right, since you're being transparent about it?
Yep. Under why, you'll find our social mission kind of in the header up under why in the top navigation, why Abenity.
Right.
There's a third tab there called our social mission on that Y Abenity page.
Okay. So the reason I was looking is because it seems like it's a little buried here. And I'm inspired by what you said about purpose-driven metrics for the team.
Yep.
I like the idea of purpose-driven metrics right there on the website. Like, I've always been a fan of this many employees helped, this much money saved for employees, and then another metric, this many kids sponsored or brought out of poverty. I love that this whole point about transparency and metrics that involve giving.
Yep. We're working on a new website, so we'll make sure that we go straight to that page. And we just published a few months ago our impact report, which breaks out where every dollar went.
Right.
I think we're a little over 1.2 million at this point.
Yeah, I can't help myself. I'm so much a fan of what you've brought up, this idea of purpose-driven metrics. I'd like to see them on the website, right front and center. Yeah. This is what we're doing for the companies. This is what we're doing for the employees. And this is what we're doing for kids in poverty. Boom, boom, boom.
Mm,
that's huge, idea. Man.
I like that.
Are we up to number six?
Number six. The last one. So Peter Drucker's famous for saying culture eats strategy for breakfast. But this idea of culture, I think, is really overrated, because culture is just an output. You're gonna have a healthy culture or an unhealthy culture. It's kind of the holy grail of culture is community, and so really number six was community. We built a community of team members, all about our cause, fully loyal to our brand, our suppliers, our clients, and community is a process. We're sponsoring kids. So our employees and their kids started being pen pals with the kids we're sponsoring, and all our kids we sponsor in Senegal is in Senegal. So we started building community with them. Part of the group that we're supporting is called World Vision, and they have an annual gift catalog where local artisans in these countries are making handbags, jewelry, roasting coffee, these different things. And you can purchase these handmade artisan crafts in the catalog. And so we take about $20,000 at the end of every year, and we let our clients select one of these artisan gifts from the gift catalog. And so the clients actually receive a handcrafted bracelet from a country we're supporting, as a gift from us, extending the community to the clients.
I just got goosebumps. I got goosebumps over my whole body hearing that.
Oh, well, that's so neat. So it's been so cool building these external partnerships, and building a community around this cause. And essentially when you're in a community, you are in that situation where the fight and the endurance is greater than whatever situation you're stuck in. Now, our team is a fully remote team. Everybody has always worked from home. We've done that since 2006. That became, and one thing I think that really is important to stay fully, to be a successful fully remote team, is having shared purpose and having this community that you build around, because you're not physically together and you have to have more to connect in your relationships when we're physically distant from each other. My biggest concern about 2020 is it forced everyone into remote work. And a lot of people are like, wow, mind blown, remote work is possible. It's saving us money. People are getting along, but it's been built on a counterfeit foundation of shared purpose. Everyone has had the common purpose of fighting against the negativity that happened in 2020, fighting against COVID. And as soon as that cause that they've all been fighting against dissipates, they're all going to realize they're on shallow ground and their foundation will be washed away. And they're going to have a bunch of employees living on an island without shared purpose anymore, without community, without a cause they're rallied around. And these remote teams that worked so well in 2020 and 2021 are going to start to crumble unless these companies can build some purpose around their brand. And that's really why I put together this one-page impact plan we were talking about before the show, to help companies put together a formula where they are working for something bigger than themselves. They're crafting a message that they communicate out to whoever they want to communicate it to, and a one-page kind of five-step plan formula just gets them thinking and gets them started.
I love that. How old are you?
I just turned 40.
40. All right. I you know, you look young to me. This guy could be like 25 or something.
No.
Well, man, I'm impressed. I'm impressed with what you've created. I'm impressed that with your Inc. 5000 success, and the fact that you're making a difference for the world, and you've gone beyond that. You're like, okay, well, we're making a difference, but now I want to help others make a difference. So you've gone meta. How can people find out about you if they either want perks for their company and their employees, or they want to create a socially driven business?
Yep. Thanks. Great question. So if you use the coupon code FOCUS, we'll give you $150 off your own perks program for your own employees or your members. So that's kind of number one. Take the code FOCUS to abenity.com and sign up that way to get started. Programs are ready next day.
Let me clarify. Was that FOCUS, F-O-C-U-S, or focused with an E-D on the end?
F-O-C-U-S.
Okay, FOCUS. Yep. Go to abenity.com and use the coupon FOCUS for a discount. Okay.
And then in my new, we didn't talk about it a lot. It was in the bio, but I have hired leadership to fully run Abenity, and I'm really working on unpacking what has helped us get to where we are. And I'm doing that. And I'm really looking to connect with other leaders who want to join in community around building brands for a bigger purpose. So if you text the word impact to my phone number, you can join my community there to be a part of this community of people fighting for causes outside of their brand. And my phone number to do that is area code 615-802-6853. And if you do the word impact, then you'll get an auto response as well with my one-page impact report, so you can start brainstorming what you need to think through to build a social mission of your own.
Great. And that number again was 615-802-6853. Text the word impact for this impact report. Wow, man, you are a legend in your own time. And I'm really glad to have you on the show. Thanks for being here.
Absolutely. This was a pleasure. Nice to meet you.
All right. Ciao, Brian.
Thanks so much.
You've been listening to Extraordinary Focus with David Wood. Now, to achieve way more in less time, to double your business and your impact in the world, and to be an even more extraordinary entrepreneur and human, make sure you get your gift basket. It includes a cheat sheet to double your focus, a short video to implement the steps, and a free focus audit to identify the number one focus leak in your business and how to plug it. To get all three of these goodies, just go to myfocusgift.com. If you've gotten value out of this episode, tell your friends. And nothing says keep up the good work, David, like a review, which helps us climb in the rankings and reach more listeners. Now, let's be extraordinary.